How you doing? I feel like a lounge singer with this. I don't know why. This is just so weird. I haven't used one of these forever because I'm kind of animated, so I don't know how people do this. People are going back to this, you know that? But I like to be hands-free. But anyway, if you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Daniel chapter 6, verse 1. Daniel chapter 6, verse 1. And the title of today's message is The Key to Daniel's Power. And how many know we should want to know the key to Daniel's power, because Daniel's a pretty amazing man, amen? He was an amazing man. I mean, the guy, he served under three different kings and prospered with every place he went. Every king he served under, he prospered. How many like to be like that? I like to prosper wherever I go. I like that about Joseph. You know, he goes to Potiphar's house, he prospers. He goes to jail, he prospers. Wherever he went, he prospered. And I believe God. And I don't mean Lear jets and stuff like that. But how many know God wants us to be successful? God wants us to honor his name. God wants us to bring him fame. Amen. And he does that by the excellence of his people. And I believe God really wants us that we should be, how many know, we come to him kind of a wreck, a lot of us. But how many know God wants to clean you up? God loves you so, he loves you just the way you are, but he loves you so much, he's not going to leave you and I this way. And so we should give ourselves to that. I want to tell a little funny story. Anyone hear a funny story? Here it is. It's a good story here. It says, as a bagpiper, I played many gigs. Recently, I was asked by a funeral director to play at a graveside service for a homeless former bagpipesman, and I guess I didn't know it was called a bagpipesman, but that's what it's called. He had no family or friends, so the service was not to be at a pauper's, was to be at a pauper's cemetery in the backwoods of Kentucky. I was not familiar with the backwoods, so I got lost, and being a typical man, I didn't stop to ask for directions. Amen. And finally, I arrived about an hour late. I saw the funeral guy, and he had evidently gone, and the hearse was nowhere in sight, and there were only diggers and the crew left, and they were eating lunch, and I felt badly, and I apologized to the men for being so late. I went to the side of the grave and looked down, and the vault lid was already closed, and I didn't know what else to do, so I started to play. The workers put down their lunches and began to gather around. I played out my heart for this and soul for this man with no family or friends. I played like I never played before for this homeless man. As I played Amazing Grace, the workers began to weep. I began to weep. We all wept together. When I finished, I packed up my bagpipes and started for my car. Though my head hung low, my heart was full. As I opened the door to my car, I heard one of the workers say, I've never seen nothing like this before in all my life. And I've been digging septic tanks for over 20 years. I like that. I stole that from Ravi Zacharias. That's pretty good, huh? Following the incredible military upset, remember last week we saw how there was King Belshazzar and how he was, the Medes and the Persians were camped outside his palace and his walls. Remember, his walls were 320 feet high, 80 feet thick. And so he was so confident that he partied instead of getting ready to fight. And then he went even further, remember, he then took the articles that Nebuchadnezzar had won or had taken from the temple of God, and he said, let's drink out of them and worship our gods. And what happened? You remember? A hand on the wall. That's where we get the handwritings on the wall. This hand started writing on the wall. Meeny, meeny, techno, leufarsin, I think that's it. Meeny, meeny, techno, farsin. It meant your life is weighed in the balance and it's left wanting. And then what happened? That night, the Medes and the Persians, they defeated the Babylonians, the most powerful empire in the known world. And this is where we pick it up today. Now, the Medo-Persian empires, the Medes and the Persians are now combined together. And so you have basically a co-reigning. You have two kings, and Darius, we're going to see today. And there's also, at the end of this chapter, we're going to see it's Cyrus. Darius was for the Medes, and Darius was for the Medes, and Cyrus was for the Persians. That's where we're going to take it up today. Let's pray and ask God to continue to bless this time. Lord, we thank you so much. We thank you for the worship today. We thank you for your love and just for your goodness. And I pray, God, that you would just right now, that you would anoint me to teach your word, Lord. That, Father God, your word is anointed. We don't have to pray a blessing on your word, but we ask that, Lord, as I teach your word, as I interpret your word, I pray that I would do it rightly and that I would rightly divide it. I would speak exactly the way you would have me speak it to your people. Nothing more, nothing less. So, God, bless it. Bless your word. Bless the teaching of your word. Bless it to where every heart is touched. I pray for rhema words, Lord. I pray that everyone would leave here saying, I heard from God, not from Craig Roeders, but as I preach your word, let your spirit wrap around and touch hearts to where everyone leaves here knowing that you are alive and you are well and you speak through your word. So, Father, speak now. Speak to your people. And, Father, I ask that we would learn how to have the power that Daniel had, how to walk in that excellence that Daniel walked in. And we ask this in the mighty name of Jesus. And everyone agreed, said?
Amen.
Amen. Verse 1. It pleased Darius, or Darius, some people say, but Darius is what most people say. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 satraps, or officers, to be over the whole kingdom. 120 officers to rule over 120 provinces. You could say that. That's kind of what that's saying. And then over these 120 were three governors, verse 2. Of whom Daniel was number one. The satraps might give an account to them so that the king would not suffer loss. So a lot of these governors, officers were robbing from the kingdom. They were robbing. And so these three governors were supposed to watch over them and make sure none of them would steal from the kingdom. And so that's what Darius has done. He's set over. And there's three governors, over 120 officers, and Daniel is ahead of them all. Verse 3, this Daniel distinguished himself above the governors and satraps, hear this, because he had an excellent spirit. I don't know about you, but I want to have an excellent spirit, amen? I want that to be said of me, an excellent spirit, and we'll see who that is, was in him, and the king gave thought to setting him over the whole realm. How many know the saying says that you can't keep a good man down? And every time Joseph or Daniel was in a place of authority, a place, they always rose to the top. And I don't know about you, but that should be us. Amen? That should be us. Wherever we work, we, Christ in us, should rise to the top. Because all of us, how many know, if you're saved, you have an excellent spirit in you. You have an excellent spirit in you. You might not be excellent on your own, but when you're in Christ, you have an excellent spirit in you. Remember the chest of silver, as we saw the statue, was the head of gold, was Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonians, and now the chest of silver is the Medes and the Persian Empire. Now they have just defeated Babylon, as I said, and Darius the Mede was the man appointed with Cyrus the Persian to rule over Babylon. We're going to hear about Cyrus at the end of this chapter, but right now you just have Darius, the Mede, is the one who is managing Babylon. Now, how did Daniel, verse 3, distinguish himself above all the other governors? It says Darius realized that he had an excellent spirit. This excellent spirit was within Daniel. And what was the spirit? I believe it was none less than what? The Holy Spirit. That's why, you look, every time when you see Jesus do something powerful, when you see the disciples do something powerful, they always said, Peter being filled with the Holy Spirit, Jesus being filled with the Holy Spirit, being filled with the Holy Spirit. And how many know that's important, that we are filled with the Holy Spirit? Amen. Every day, I tell you this, I try to live this every single day, is that before my feet hit the carpet, that I pray, Lord, fill me with your Holy Spirit. Empower me to live for you. Amen? We need that because we can't do this. Apart from me, Jesus said, you can do nothing. And how many know some of us are doing nothing? But how many know God wants us to do something powerful, and we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit if we're going to do something that distinguishes us above other people. Daniel interpreted, hear this, just some of the things he did. He interpreted dreams, and he didn't just interpret dreams. He literally, people could not tell him the dream. Remember, Nebuchadnezzar didn't tell him the dream.
So he then prays and gets the dream. Then he interprets the dream that he didn't get from him. He got it from God. I mean, that's pretty awesome. I always love, we were at a place and there was a bunch of charismatics and we were there and it was so neat. This guy goes, yes, I feel like someone out there has a problem with their back. And he says, anyone out there have a problem with their back? And the one person goes, yeah, it's me. And he goes, I knew it was you. How many know? That's great, isn't it? I knew it was you. How many would be a lot better? Hey, I believe it's you. That's when you know. Whoa, how did you know it was you? I'll never forget one time I was in a service and this man, I was at a church up in Phoenix, the Assembly of God Church, about a 7,000 member church. And the seats like 7,000 people at Tommy Arnett's church. And all of a sudden this guy goes, he goes, you in the back there. And I was way far back, and he goes, you. And I'm like, and I'm looking around, who's you? And he goes, you, God wants you to know he loves you and that he's a father to the fatherless. And a matter of fact, you never have had a father. And God, how many know that's pretty intense? Now, you could say you've had a, you know, you have a good chance. You say, have you had a problem? I feel like you've had a problem with your father. You got a 50-50 shot on that. But to say you've never had a father, that narrows it down a lot. But how many know that's what the Holy Spirit can do? That's called a word of knowledge. That's called prophetic. That's what the Holy Spirit does. So he interpreted dreams. He prayed with effectiveness. He understood visions. He moved prophetically, as we're going to see in chapters ahead. He experienced miraculous, as we're going to see today. He's going to be delivered from lions. In other words, he was a man, as I said, filled with the Holy Spirit. And I don't know about you, but I believe that if we're going to minister to this day and age, how many know it's a little tough out there? We have got to be filled with the Spirit of God. You can't do it, not by Zechariah 4:6, not by human might, not by human power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. How many know this? God bless, you know, God bless someone like Ted Cruz that's running, and he's a godly man, and that would be so great, but how many know Ted Cruz is not going to save America? God is going to work through him, but how many know it's going to be us partnering with the Spirit in Ted Cruz to see America turned around? Amen. It's us walking. That was a weak amen. Amen. But it's us walking by the Spirit. It's us getting sick and tired of being sick and tired. And I will tell you this. You know, some of you, I kind of felt this. You know, we worship a long time here. How many know that? And some of you are like, okay, we got it. Okay, we got it. Okay. How many know you're going to be worshiped for the rest of your life? In heaven, you're going to worship. I mean, sometimes it needs to get deep in our spirit that we need God and we can't do without him and we need to surrender to him. I can't live without, we could say it this way, I can't live without your Spirit. But yet, I will say sadly, a lot of times I think I can do a lot on my own. But guess what? What I do on my own isn't very successful. It doesn't distinguish me. It doesn't make me rise to the top. But how many know? Every one of you in this room can be used greatly by God if you'll surrender yourself to the Holy Spirit. Did you hear that? Did you hear what Jesus said? Remember Jesus said, he said to John the Baptist, he says, no man born of a woman is greater than John the Baptist. But then Jesus says, and we could go, oh, sad, you know, I can't even be great. He says, but if you want to be great, then be a servant. Hey, if you want to be the greatest, then be the slave of all. Isn't that amazing? In the kingdom of God, you and I can be great. But what do we have to be? A servant of the Most High God. To say, God, I'll do whatever you want. I'll go wherever you want. I'll say whatever you want. And I mean, that's what separates the men from the boys. Because guess what? I like being the ruler of my life. And I say that sadly. But we do, don't we? We like it. We like to call the shots. But how many know this? Submit therefore to God. Resist the devil and he must flee. And what? Draw near to God and he what? Will draw near to you. You have as much of God as you want. And I hope you guys are wanting more and more of God. When I was worshiping, I just said, more, God. I just want more of you. Less of me, more of you. Amen? 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 He was filled with the Holy Spirit. And that's what made him so successful. All the days of his life, he was successful. 2 Chronicles 16:9 is one of my favorite verses. I say every verse is my favorite, but this is a verse I really love. It says, the eyes of the Lord search the whole earth in order to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. Do you hear that? God is searching the whole earth. Why does he have to search the whole earth? Because there's not that many who are really surrendered to him, amen? But he's searching the whole earth in order to find someone who's fully committed to him that he can what? Strengthen. That he can move powerfully through. Can I just say, I know you guys go, Craig, I don't want to do this. How many of you, could, for a show to God, not to me, you want to be that man or woman? That you want to be where God, you are fully committed and where he can strengthen you, amen? And I tell you, I hear that. The Lord, he's not saying, I'm only looking for the chosen people. He says, I'm looking for any man or any woman to strengthen whose heart is what? Fully committed. So guess what, church? You and I can be as strengthened and as filled with the Spirit as you and I want. God's going to go, I don't know if you're good enough for my spirit. I don't know if you're quite the caliber of person I want. How many know God uses the weak things, the foolish things to confound the wise? That's why I'm here. No, but anyway, you know, I mean, I never forget. Does anyone know Skip Heitzig? Does anyone know Skip Heitzig? Yeah, Skip Heitzig gave me a really encouraging word when I started being a senior pastor. He said, he goes, hey, buddy, you are going to do so good. You're going to be awesome. I can just see it. I know it. I can just tell. And I was like, wow, Skip Heitzig, Sam would be awesome. And he goes, you know why? Because he's the weak things, the foolish things. And you are weak and foolish. And I know it's going to be great. And I'm like, I don't like you, surfer boy. You know, but anyway. Our Heavenly Father is still looking for men and women today in whom he can show himself strong. And he can do mighty exploits through, as he did with Daniel. And guess what? God is no respecter of persons. Do you hear that? Sometimes, I don't know about you, but I was in a denomination for a while that kind of felt like there was special people. And that you were either chosen or you weren't. And that you were either hot or cold. You were either, you could be destined for nothing. How many of that will not make you seek God? But if you believe the truth that you can have as much of God as you want, then how many know? You'll seek God if you're smart. Because you'll go, my goodness, the only one stopping me from being used mightily by God is me. The only one. What does the Bible say? No one can separate you from the love of God. The only one who can separate you is you. Not a demon, not Satan, not a bad husband or wife. Only you and I can separate us from the love of God and separate us from seeking God. And I'm here to tell you this. I think sometimes, I was reading, I think it was Spurgeon. He was saying that sometimes our hardships are the very things. We say, oh, it's because of this hardship I can't see God. Those are the very things that wake us up to need God. And how many know, if America doesn't turn around, there will be some hardships. You think it's hard now. We're still pretty blessed. So a lot of you still go on vacation. You still have clothes on, right? You're still blessed. But how many know God could say, okay, let's turn it up a little. And I mean, I'd like to not have to have that to realize I need God. We need God. Amen. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm just saying the reality, right? Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. If we turn God out of, if we say, God, get out of America, guess what? If he honors us, guess what happens to America? Like every other country that's forgotten God. Crash. Verse 4. So the governors and satraps sought to find a charge against Daniel. They were jealous of Daniel. Concerning the kingdom, but they could find no charge or fault. Wouldn't that be great about us? If we could be so godly that if we ran for president, we wouldn't have to be afraid of all, oh no, oh, that thing I didn't go, here it comes, oh my. How many know a lot of us have lives that we could not run for president? Now, hear me, if it's under the blood, then it's great. I'll never forget, I was at the post office over here, and this person came up to me and says, Craig, I know something about your past. And I need some money. And I'm like, what? And they go, I know this thing about your past. And I said, you know what, Satan? No, kidding, I didn't say that. I said, you know, the Bible says that the devil is the accuser of the brethren. And you know that thing you think you got over me? That's under the blood. I've dealt with it. And that happened over 25 years ago. So guess what? It's under. You can exploit me all you want. I don't care because I am right with God. And I know that. Some of you here in this room hear that. Don't think, well, I've blown. I can never be used by God. No. Put it under the blood. Get it right with those you need to get right. And realize when the devil comes to accuse you, hey, it's under the blood. Amen? He says he casts our sin, those that we dealt with, as far as the east is from the west. He casts in the sea of forgetfulness. And how many know on his sea of forgetfulness, he's got a sign that says no fishing. And sometimes we try to, but remember, Lord, but I did that one thing. No, it's under. And know that you can start fresh. But anyway, so that was free. Charge against Daniel concerning the kingdom, but they could find no charge or fault because he was faithful. How many know God wants faithful men and women today? Nor was there any error or fault found in him. He didn't cheat on his taxes. Everything he did was integrous. Everything he did was integrity. Verse 5. And these men said, we shall not find any charge against him. How many know that's good when your enemies can't find anything against you? This Daniel, unless we find it against him concerning the law of his God. How many know Satan is pretty weaselly? He'll go, he'll find anything. And he goes, you know what? We can't get him with integrity, so we'll get him with God. And here it is. Jealous of Daniel's excellent spirit and him kind of rising to the top, yet they were unable to find fault with him, so they could only attack his walk with God. How many of you know that that is happening today in America? How many know it's already happened in Canada? In Canada, there's a the Supreme Court had ruled back, I think, in 2013, they ruled that biblical speech opposing homosexuality is considered a hate crime. Has anyone heard that? Did they do that? Yeah, did you hear, you know what I'm talking about? Yeah, they did that, a hate crime. Now hear this. That's, people are wanting that in America. You say, no, yes, and I'll tell you about it. Many, this means that if a pastor in Canada preaches 1 Corinthians 6:9, that says, don't you realize that those who do wrong will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't fool yourselves. Those who indulge in sexual sin, fornication, or the worship of idols, or commit adultery, or are male prostitutes, or practice homosexuality shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Isn't that amazing? That is a scripture that got Phil Roberts in trouble. Remember Phil Roberts, the bearded guy? He looks like ZZ Top. Remember? He got in trouble because he quoted this verse in GQ magazine. I don't know why he was in GQ magazine. That was his first mistake. But he quoted this verse. And it was, you know what made me sad? Even Bill O'Reilly from the O'Reilly Factor, he said, well, you know, Phil should have known not to quote his opinion. He should have just known the scripture of Matthew 7 of judge not lest you be judged. How many know that's the number one scripture memorized today? It used to be John 3:16. Now it's judge not lest you be judged. But the same chapter says you'll know them by their fruit. How do you judge a tree if you don't judge it? Do you go up to a tree? I can't judge you. You have these rigged round things on it, but I don't want to say you're an apple tree. That would just be wrong. And he knew that scripture, but somehow he didn't, he wasn't able, with all his 100 researchers, he couldn't find out that 1 Corinthians 6:9 is what Phil Roberts was quoting. That makes me sad, because it says the spin stops here. Baloney. He could, if a pastor preached that verse, if I preached through 1 Corinthians, and we go right through the word, so I don't park on this, but I'm just saying this, he could be arrested just like Daniel. How many of you know that, as I said, there's a lot of people in America that want this? They want this law to be passed. They've already tried to pass it like 3 or 4 times. You go, what? Yeah. Ted Cruz, Senator Ted Cruz was telling me, not me, we meet together. No. Ted was speaking in D.C., and I heard him speak, and he was saying about, I think, 3-4 years ago, I'm thinking, he was saying that they will do a bill, and it's so amazing. I could not be a senator or politician because all the scamming, wow, it's just crazy. But he was saying to a bunch of pastors, he was saying that what happens is they did a bill to give the troops a raise. I mean, that's a good thing, give our troops a raise, right? And but in these bills, it's not just one thing. There's lots of little things behind the bill. And he says behind the bill was that chaplains couldn't preach in the name of Jesus, and they couldn't talk against homosexuality. And he said, if we allow that, that'll set the precedence for all pastors to not be able to speak what the Bible says about homosexuality. Now hear me, I'm not picking on homosexuals. People say, you're a homophobe. No, I'm just a Jesus-phobe. Well, that's wrong. I am Jesus correct. You know, we got to get to where we're not PC anymore. We got to get JC correct. JC. We got to say, I want the truth. And hear this. You know, people say, why do you pick on this? Can I just say this is free too? When I get in trouble, I say free things. But it's so amazing to me. I'll speak things like this and people say, Craig, you're so judgmental. I hate you. You're judgmental. Isn't it funny that you're judging me for the very thing you say I do? For judgment. Isn't that amazing? It's funny how the people who cry out for tolerance are some of the most intolerant people there are. What does tolerance mean? It means that we agree to disagree, but I tolerate your right to be dumb. I love you as a person. I will not kill you for your belief, but I disagree with you firmly. But guess what? Tolerance today is, tolerance is you will agree with me. And we're going to shut you up, even though we have First Amendment right. We're going to try to stop that because we believe it's a hate crime to speak what the Bible says or to speak what your religion. Hear this. I'm against, and I like this. Ted Cruz said this again. We believe in the freedom of religion. Amen? But if your religion says kill the infidel, we have a problem with your religion. Amen? If our religion said kill the homosexual, if I said that, guys, homosexual is wrong. Kill any homosexual. That is wrong. Amen? It's wrong. Because the Bible says love your enemy, pray for them. So that's wrong. Okay? But we should be free to say what the Bible says about homosexuality, about adultery. It says all that. It doesn't just pick on homosexuality. It says adultery, fornication, pornography. That's all in there. He says, those who practice that shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But how many know this world that we live in is trying to say that will be a hate crime and you'll be shut down? How many know I'm going to jail if that law passes? Because I will have to preach. I cannot say that. And you know someone's going to try me. What do you think about homosexuality? Tape recorder. You guys will visit me, right? Okay, good. Hopefully you'll be with me. I don't even know anything. No. Okay. I always hate it. Verse 6. So the governor's satraps and throng before the king and said thus to him, King Darius, live forever. All the governors of the kingdom... All the governors, now hear this, we know they're lying here because there's three governors, right? Two of them did this because we know they didn't talk to Daniel about this, so they lied to the king. All the governors of the kingdom and the administrators, satraps, and counselors, advisors have consulted together to establish a royal statute and to make a firm decree that whoever petitions any god or man for 30 days, except you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions. Verse 8, now, O king, establish your decree and sign the writing so that they cannot be changed according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which does not alter. They were, as we studied, remember before, they're a constitutional monarchy. That means they're like the Queen of England. They can go, hello. That means that they are not an absolute monarchy like Nebi was, King Nebuchadnezzar. He could just say, you're dead, and not have to vote on it. He could then say, no, you live, and you don't have to vote on it. He was an absolute power. But these guys had a monarchy, and so they had these counselors, they had these governors, and they'd have to vote on it and say, I don't think we should do that, king. Sorry, you can't go back on it. And so what the king said went. They also believe, as historians say, that they believe that these kings spoke for God, and so that God would never rescind what he said because gods can't be wrong. So I know it's not good to be... a human god, because you mess up. And you're going to see that he realizes, oh my, I messed up. Verse 9, therefore King Darius signed the written decree. Verse 10, and Daniel knew that the writing was signed. He went home in his upper room, and with his windows open towards Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as was his custom since the early days. And he was taken about 15. So he's done this from about 15 years of age to about 85 for a long time, 70 years, right? In political maneuver meant to frame Daniel exclusively, Darius's governors, his two other governors, submitted a law that under a penalty of death for 30 days, no one could make a request to any god or man other than Darius himself. Notice that Daniel didn't say this. Hear this, guys, because this sometimes can be us. Notice he didn't say, I'll show you, you made this stupid law. I'll show you. Now I'm going to get down on my knees and show you my radical Christianity by breaking some laws and praying to Jesus. How many know that wasn't what Daniel did? This was his custom. He just kept doing what he's always been doing. He wasn't like, hey, I've never prayed in my life before, but now I'm going to start praying because it's illegal to pray. How many know, you know, that's not what we should do. That's not what we should do. We should be praying because we should be praying. And then when they say don't pray, then we should say, I'm going to still pray. Amen? It wasn't rebellion here. No. His heart was, I'm going to do what I've been doing for the past 70 plus years. I'm going to open my window and pray to the God I love and I have loved for the last 70 years. And he had been doing this, as I said, for all his life. Now hear this, guys. I believe, and hear this well, because, you know, sometimes, have you noticed in the politics that people can take one quote And it's and just if you take it one quote, it sounds terrible. How many know that? So hear me, wake up. If you're asleep now, wake up, okay? Because I want you to hear this. Because some of you are going to go, what? Romans 13:1 says, everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities. That means that we should obey the laws of the land. Amen? Then you sound real excited about that. You should, okay? But hear this. We should obey the laws of men, but there's times when God calls us to disobey the laws of men. How many know that this Wednesday is one of our founding fathers' birthday? It's Jefferson, Thomas Jefferson's birthday. You know what Thomas Jefferson said? He said, sometimes the tree of liberty has to be watered by the blood of patriots. Wow, that almost seems like you should be arrested for that. That's one of our founding fathers said that. That there's a time when you say, government, no. Isn't that how this country started? We said, government, you're oppressive. You're not letting us have freedom of religion. You're taxing us, and enough. And I remember saying that on my radio show, and they go, but you're supposed to obey the laws of the land. Like, and then I guess you should move out of America because we're a bunch of rebels. But hear this. Here's why. How many know this, guys? The Bible is full of paradoxes. Not contradictions, but hear this. If you don't know, have the Spirit of God, you'll think, hey, there's a contradiction. It's not a contradiction. You're to obey the laws of men. The Bible says that. But here's the balance. Here it is. You obey the laws of men unless they break the laws of God. Amen? And here it is in Acts 5:29. This is the balance of the other way. The Pharisees and Sadducees have told Peter and the other apostles to stop preaching the name of Jesus. They actually told them to stop so much that they arrested them. But then hear this. You're going to love this. I just read this. This is great. Read this on your own. Not now. Later. But read this. They get arrested. They're in jail. And at night, an angel comes and releases them. Then the angel, talk about rebels, the angel says, keep preaching in his name. Can you imagine that? The angel said, hey, get arrested again. I mean, that's basically what he's saying. Do it again. And so the first thing in the morning, they got released, the cells open. They come first thing in the morning, start preaching. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Supreme Court of their day said, where are those guys we arrested yesterday? they're not there. Where are they? They're preaching in the temple again. They went and arrested them again without incident. And they said to them, did we not tell you to not preach in the name of Jesus? Are you guys hard of hearing? That's the Message Bible. You know, you guys aren't going to laugh, are you? No. But he says, no. He says, they say this. Here's what their response was. They said, Peter and the apostles replied, we must obey God rather than human authority. We must obey God rather than men. And how many know this, guys? Some of us are so PC that, hear this. Remember what I told you in the Romans? The Roman Christians, they would say to them, all you had to do is throw a pinch to Caesar, a pinch of incense, and say, Caesar is Lord, and you could be not persecuted for 1 year. But the Christians in Rome, primarily most of them, said, no way, and they were fed to the lions. They were killed. They were burned on crosses. They were lit on fire. They would be burned to death. How many Christians do you think today in America would justify that and say, God, you know, I didn't really mean it. I was crossing my fingers. We need to sometimes rebel against the laws of men when they go against the laws of God. Amen? And I think if things don't change in America, there's going to be a time when yours truly is going to have to break the law and say, speak the truth in love and say, you know what? I know what you're telling me to do, but I have to stand. And not so I can make national news, but just to say, I am not going to let you tell me what I can and cannot say, because one, it's our constitutional right we've had for 230 years, and two, the Bible says I have to obey God rather than man. Amen? Amen? Let's give the Lord a clap on that. Amen? Verse 11, then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. 12, and they went before the king and spoke concerning the king's decree. Have you not signed a decree that every man who petitions any god or man within 30 days except you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? The king answered and said, this thing is true. according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which does not alter. See, it can't be changed. Verse 13, so they answered and said before the king that Daniel, who is one of the captives from Judah, does not show due regard for you, O king, or for the decree that you have signed, but makes his petitions three times a day. Verse 14, the king, when he had heard these words, was greatly displeased with himself. And hear this, he was displeased with himself because he realized, I've been flattered, I've been duped, I can't believe I fell for these weasels trying to get me to frame Daniel. He says he was displeased with himself and set his heart on Daniel to deliver him. He was saying he was trying to find a way to break his own law. And he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. It was that the Medes and the Persians would execute people at evening. Verse 15, these men approached the king and said to the king, know, O king, that this is the law of the Medes and the Persians, that no decree or statute which the king and establishes may be changed. Verse 16, so the king gave the command, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. But the king spoke, saying to Daniel, your God whom you serve continually will deliver you. Hear this, guys. He's not saying it like, hey, Daniel, I've messed up, but your God will deliver you, right? He's kind of asking like a question, like, I've messed up, but Daniel, your God will deliver you, right? I mean, even though I've messed up, he'll deliver you. He's not saying like, I know he will. He's asking a question like, I hope he'll deliver you because I've messed up big time. Verse 17, then a stone was brought and laid on the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring and the signets of his lords, that the purpose concerning Daniel might not be changed. Verse 18, now the king went to his palace and spent the night fasting, and no musicians were brought before him. Also, he slept, his sleep went from him. He didn't sleep all night because of this. Verse 19, then the king arose very early in the morning, went in haste to the den of lions. Verse 20, and came to Daniel, to the den. He cried out with a lamenting voice to Daniel. The king spoke, saying to Daniel, Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God whom you serve continually been able to deliver you from the lions? Darius couldn't sleep. He refused. He rushed early in the morning to see if Daniel's God had delivered him. And guess what the answer was? An emphatic yes. Isn't that cool? Yes. Can you imagine sleeping with... I one time had a little baby Bengal tiger put on my lap, and his paws were as big. He was only a year old, and his paws were as big as my hand. I have a pretty big hand. His paws, remember that? I mean, I had the picture, but my daughter lost it. Where's Mariah? You troublemaker. But anyways, really cool. And I can't imagine what it's like to be thrown in a den of lions, these ferocious lions, and here he is, but he was delivered by God. Some of you today need to know that God can deliver you from your lion's den. Some of you need to believe that God can deliver you from sickness. Some of you need to believe that God can deliver you from your financial struggle. Some of you need to believe that God can deliver you from, not deliver you, but help your marriage, bless your marriage. You need to know that God is in the business of deliverance. He can deliver you maybe from a demonic oppression. God is a delivering God. And as I said, he's no respecter of persons, and he will deliver you. Verse 21, then Daniel said to the king, O king, live forever. Isn't that amazing? Here he is. I'd be saying, get me out of here. He says, O king, live forever. He's like probably having a little coffee or something, you know. I mean, he's just like relaxed, you know. It's no big deal. I'm just with a bunch of hungry, angry lions, you know, no big deal. Verse 22, my God sent his angel, hear that, his angel, and shut the lion's mouth so they have not hurt me because I was found innocent before him. And also, king, I have done no wrong before you. Who did God send to rescue Daniel? He sent his angels. Now hear this. Some commentators say that this, when it says his angel, that it's the angel of the Lord. It's a Christophany. It's a pre-incarnate Christ. That it's Christ. Just like, you remember the time earlier, I think it's chapter 3, where Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were in the fiery furnace. And remember, it says, Nebuchadnezzar goes, how many do we throw in there? And he says, we threw in 3. And he goes, well, why is there a fourth one? And the fourth one looks like the Son of God. And so Jesus is in the fire with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And the same language here, I'm not a Hebrew scholar or I guess Aramaic scholar, but they're saying the same language is like that same language. So it's probably Jesus who spent the night with Daniel in the lion's den. And how many know lions with Jesus are probably little kitties? You know, they're probably just petting him. You know, could you imagine? I mean, I think that's, how many know in the 1,000-year reign, we're going to have that, things like that. We're going to be able to wrestle polar bears. We're going to be able to play with rattlesnakes. I can't wait. I want to wrestle a polar bear. I'm going to beat a polar bear. I want to wrestle a polar bear. You know what I mean? That would be so much fun, wouldn't it? I mean, these big animals just be like, hey, you know, I'd love to wrestle my dog. He gets scared of me. But I'd love to wrestle a big bear that could maybe throw me, whoa, and, you know, and hopefully not kill me because they're nice now. But anyways, it was the angel of God. The angel shut the mouth of lions. And how many of you know that his angels are watching over you and I right now? His angels are watching. I just want to give you a few scriptures. I'm going to go fast here so I don't go too long. Psalms 91:11 says, for he will order his angels to protect you wherever you go, verse 12, and they will hold you up with their hands so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone. How many know that's a pretty powerful verse because Satan quoted that verse to Jesus. So Satan knows that there's angels that block him, and that's why he quoted that verse to Jesus, say, hey, You're protected by angels, so you can just jump off the temple. You can do whatever you want because you can't get hurt. And what did he say? You should not test or tempt the Lord thy God. You should not, you don't just jump off stuff and say, hey, God will protect me. But God will protect you when you need protection. Amen? Psalms 34:7, real quick. That one, I love that one. I don't know if I have it down, but Psalms 34, verse 7 says, the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him. You know what I pray for you guys, and I pray for my family, and I pray that we will pray this. Lord, teach me the fear of the Lord. Because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of all wisdom. But also, he says, the angel of the Lord encamps. How many would like angels encamping around their cars? Encamping around their houses? I told you a story where we're driving, all of a sudden this big tanker truck just goes blowing through a red light. We're like a block away. Remember that, Mariah? And I was like, I'm like, whoa. How many know there's an angel going, okay, slow the car down, you know? I mean, sometimes we get mad at traffic. I think that's God protecting us sometimes, you know? There's a tanker maybe going to go there. But that angel, it says the angel of the Lord encamps around them and protects them, delivers them. We should be praying that every day for our lives. And lastly, Matthew 18:10, it says, take heed that you do not despise one of these little ones, little children. For I say to you, this is Jesus talking, that in heaven their angels, not one, just angels, more than one, their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. How many know that? Kids have angels. And I was just thinking about that. How many know that there's a lot of angels that have their hearts broken of what happens sometimes to kids? How many know, I heard a story, I'll just say this real quick. And I, you know, you hear these stories, you don't know how true they are, but it sure is a good story if it is true. But where this little kid was, his dad came home drunk and he shot his mom and then he shot himself. Anyone heard this story? And then all of a sudden the kid was hiding behind the couch when this happened. And all of a sudden the kid goes to Sunday school, he's put in a foster home, he goes to a Christian church, a Sunday school, and there he had a picture of Jesus and he goes, I know him. And they go, how do you know him? He goes, he stood with me behind the couch when my dad killed my mommy. I mean, that's pretty cool. That's true. That's pretty neat that Jesus would stand there. I mean, you know, a part of us goes, stop it! But how many know? How many know this? Hear this, guys. We blame a lot on God, but how many know it's free will? God's given us free will, and with that free will, we are able to do a lot of things that are very evil. But how many know? Hear this. I love what Ravi Zacharias says. We're all free to do whatever we want. How many know? We are. But we're not free to determine the outcome of our actions. I mean, you can lawyer up here, but you can't lawyer up in heaven. You can't lawyer up in heaven. You live for yourself. Guess what? You're going to hear maybe what? Depart from me. I never knew you. And to me, from a loving Jesus, that would be the harshest word you could ever hear in your life. And I pray that all of you are surrendered to God and you're seeking with all your heart that he might strengthen you, that you can hear what? Well done, my good and faithful servants. How many want to hear that? I want to hear that. Amen. Verse 23. Now the king was exceedingly glad for him because he blew it and he's saying, oh, I'm so glad God delivered you. And commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den and no injury whatever was found on him because he, hear this, here's the key, because he believed in his God. I want to tell you this, guys. God really cares that you believe in him. He really does. He cares that you have faith. Jesus said this in Luke 18:8. He says, when the Son of Man returns, will he find faith in all the earth? And I don't know about you, but I want us to be a church that he can find faith in. You understand that we say, Jesus, I believe you're still able to deliver. I believe, as it says in Hebrews 13, you're the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. I believe that you can heal today just like you did 2,000 years ago. I believe you can deliver people from demonic oppression just like you did 2,000 years ago. I believe that you are the same God, as your word says, the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. But how many know if we do not, how many know if Daniel said, oh no, I don't know God, you know, I don't know, maybe you won't deliver me. How many know he probably would have been munched. But it says he believed in his God. We need to believe. We need to say like Alyssa said. Sorry, I almost said the other name. Alyssa said, where she said what? Remember the man where Jesus said, Jesus, you can deliver my son. And he said, if. I know God gets a little offended. If. You're talking to me, right? If. Now, my disciples, you might be able to play that. But me, if. He says, all things are possible for those who believe. And what does the man say? Oh, I'm sorry. No, he didn't say that. He said, what? I believe, Lord. Help me to overcome my unbelief. I mean, that's a good prayer for us to pray. I believe, Lord, but I'll be honest, I still have some doubts. So help me overcome my unbelief. That's a good prayer, right? We should pray that a lot. Verse 24, and the king gave the command, and they brought those men who had accused Daniel, those two men at least, and they cast them in the den of lions, them, their children, and their wives. How many think that's not very fair? Kind of mean, isn't it? But I mean, no, that was the law of the land with the Medes and the Persians. But hear this, guys. That law is still true today. Your sin, mom and dad, affects your children. And how many know your life, you, especially dads, you are the king and you are the priest of your home. How many know that? And what you set goes. How many knows? They said this, that if a woman loves God with all her heart, her chance of her kids walking with God is like 20%. But if a husband walks with God and loves God and is the leader of the house, their children have an 80% chance of walking with God. Amen. 80%. So you can say whatever you want, the sexes. Maybe it's not fair, but that's how God made it. And guess what will happen? That family will serve God if the dad serves God. Amen. Most of the time. And I want to tell you this, dads. You're given to things you shouldn't be given to. Your kids, they say, in youth statistics, say what you do in moderation, your kids will do in excess. You don't go to church very often, guess what? Your kids, if you don't go, if you only go twice a month, they'll go twice a year. How many know it's time for us dads to step up and to realize that our sins affect our family, and we're going to give an account to God of how we've led our families. How does that put the holy fear of God in anyone here? I can see your faces. This is why we don't like you. This is why. Hey, we were listening the other night. I was kind of having fun with my daughter and kind of rebuking her on something. And, you know, I'm just a mean guy. And all of a sudden, I was listening. I don't know who it is. I forget his name, but you'll know it. But you remember that song goes, sometimes love don't feel like it should. You know it. Hurts so good. Should I go on the road or what? No, you know that song? You guys are just mellow today, aren't you? But you know that song, right? And everyone's like, and my family's like, is that sexual? What does that mean? That's just weird. I went, no, sometimes love hurts, right? How many know sometimes God love hurts? But hear this, guys. Wouldn't you rather be hurt by God through me now when you can change than hurt in eternity? Amen. Amen. Amen? So guess what? I am a more loving pastor than the dude down the street going, hey, kumbaya, my sinners, kumbaya. Homosexuality's cool. Jesus is one of the ways. No, that's not love. That is loving you all the way to hell. But I love you enough to say, hey, I'll say the hard things, and hopefully deep in your heart, you'll go, is that true, God? Is what he said. He seems like a punk most of the time. But is it true? And Jesus would say, hopefully, yes, it's true. You know, I love people when they disagree with me. They'll say, I don't agree with you. And I go, well, what scripture do you use to disagree? I don't know. I just don't agree.
Well, I go, I don't care what you agree. I don't care because I want scripture.
Hello?
I don't know. I was a problem child before Jesus.
It says in the middle of verse 24, and the lions overpowered them and broke all their bones in pieces before they even came to the bottom of the den. How many know sin is crazy? It kills, it devours, it crushes. And we should see those lions as kind of a, you know, what life is like when we disobey God. As you see, they were not the cowardly lion of the Wizard of Oz. These weren't the snuggly lion that was on my lap. These are brutal lions. These lions were bred for to be the most ferocious lions. And hear this, they were starved most of the time. That's why, how many know, it was a big miracle that they didn't touch Daniel. But how many know when you got the lion, the tribe of Judah, standing with you in the lion's den, you're safe. How many know, Daniel probably slept better than Darius did, amen? He was sleeping, probably snuggling on Jesus' lap. Hey, it's all right. And Jesus said, hey, kid, get back, you little kid. You know, I mean, it was probably, you know, it's really cool. If someone has wronged you like they did, these men did to Daniel, then guess what? Romans 12:19 is true for you just as much as it was true for Daniel. Romans 12:19, you don't have to turn there, but it says this, dear friends, never take revenge. Leave that to the righteous anger of God. For the scriptures say, I will take revenge. I will pay them back, says the Lord. How many know that God will avenge? If you have been innocent and you've done right, God will avenge. The Bible says that when people are killed, the martyrs for Jesus, all these people that are killed by the Muslims, how many know that the Christians that says that Jesus or God puts their blood under his throne and he will avenge them? And I don't know, I can't imagine what that'll be like, but do you remember this? Jesus is usually seated at the right hand of the Father. You always hear him, he's seated at the right hand. How many know when Stephen was killed, the first Christian martyr, when he was killed, it says what? It says Stephen saw Jesus standing, welcoming him. Because why? I think it touches the heart of God when his children are willing to die for him. And he stood up. He stood up. Verse 25, then King Darius wrote to all the peoples, nations, languages, dwell in all the earth. Peace be multiplied to you. Verse 26, I make a decree. Hear this. This is a pagan king now. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men must tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, steadfast forever. His kingdom is one which shall not be destroyed. His dominion shall endure to the end. Verse 27, he delivers and rescues. He works signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. He who has delivered Daniel from the power of the lions. Verse 28, so Daniel, hear this, prospered. Daniel prospered in the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus. So really, he prospered in four different kings. Four kings. Overflowing with praise to the Lord and eternal perspective, the decree of Darius sounds like it could be that pen from the Apostle Paul. How many know that? This is a pagan king saying, this God is awesome. Tremble before him. Now this is the fourth awesome thing that God has done through Daniel. He's given him the ability to interpret two dreams. Former King Nebuchadnezzar, Nebi, as I say. He has given him the gift of interpretation, the handwriting on the wall with King Belshazzar. He is now given the ability to escape from the lion's den of ferocious lions. And I think we could conclude that Daniel has been mightily, mightily blessed by God. How many can say amen to that? And this is one of the most beloved stories because why? We see the power of God flowing through his life. But hear this, guys. He was a man of prayer. He'd been praying day and night, morning, noon, and night for 70 years. So if you say, well, I'm not powerful, I'm not like Daniel, then guess what the answer is? You might need to start praying morning, noon, and night. And hear that. That's a good thing. Pray in the morning, start your day with God. Pray in the afternoon, check with God. How am I doing, God? And then at night, just close and thank God for the day. I want to encourage you this. This is free too. Ask Kevin. Kevin, wave your hand so everyone can see you right behind. There's Kevy. The one-year Bible. How many know the one-year Bible? You read the one-year Bible. I want to encourage all of you this. The Lord spoke this to me. It says in Matthew 14:7, or 15:7, I believe. It says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will bear much fruit. So if you feel like, well, I don't bear much fruit, then guess what the problem is? you're not abiding in the vine. So hear this. I want to encourage you. And Kevin can help you. We'll put it up on the screen or we'll put it on our website. We probably put it on our website. But I want to encourage you. This is what I've been encouraging all the people, leaders of this church. Read your one-year Bible. Read the daily. And don't get the caught. If you press catch up, it'll mess it up. Just read your daily. If you miss it, just miss it and go on. But read this. Read your New Testament. Read your Psalms and read the Proverbs. But get in the Word. That should probably take, what do you think, Kevin, about 10 minutes, maybe 15? 15 minutes, depending how you read. If you're me, an hour. But read it and then pray. So give about 15 minutes for prayer or reading and then give 15 minutes of prayer and see how your life changes. See if you aren't a little more patient with your wife and your kids. See if God doesn't bless you at work. See if God, if what God, Daniel did isn't true in your life. But here's what we do. We say, oh, I'm just so busy and I'm kind of giving my rest away. I better get going here. Here it is. Now, if the source of Daniel's success, as I said earlier, was the Holy Spirit. So how was he filled with the Holy Spirit? I believe it was his constant prayer. Morning, noon, and night. Constant prayer. And he probably prayed in between that, but morning, noon, and night. He prayed at least 3 times a day. And we, like Daniel, need to live lives of prayer. Because if we don't know what kind of crisis is going to pop up tomorrow. We don't know what kind of challenge is going to arise next week. We don't know if we could get that we have cancer. And, you know, if you haven't prayed, you're going to be. But if you've been praying, you go, hey, wow, this isn't fun, but God's good. And how many know when you got cancer and there's all these different questions? What do I do with this? What do I do? You need to know how to hear the voice of God. Because if you don't, you're going to freak out. Because guess what? Have you noticed doctors aren't the most friendly people? You guess what? You got cancer. Woo! Has anyone noticed that? They get excited almost about your health. Guess what? It's worse than we thought. It's like in this one doctor, you got cancer, and he just walked out of his office. I'm like, but get. Now, I'm not saying every doctor. Mike wasn't that way. He was nice. But you need to hear from God. You need to hear what God's saying about the situation. And if you don't pray, you're not going to know. But some of you might say, yeah, Pastor Craig, okay, that's good. You're a pastor. Of course, you should pray. That's all you do. Some of you might say, but Pastor Craig, I get so tired. You don't know how hard I work. I get so tired. Well, okay, so whatever. You'll look at me. But let's look at Daniel. Daniel was 85 years old here. Maybe 90. I can't even barely get on my knees now. He got on his knees and prayed 3 times a day. I would never get up. He's 85. How many years? You don't see too many 85-year-olds bouncing on their knees. Amen? But he's getting on his knees to pray 3 times a day. How many know? Daniel would say, shame on you, you weasels. You know? You can do it. But how many know? There's some work to prayer. It really is. Have you noticed your brain's full of a lot of stuff? Have you ever prayed? I love when you pray. This is great. I love when you pray. You're just praying, you know. And I don't worry about my roof or anything else in my house. But when I pray, I was like, oh, my goodness, I got to cool my roof. Know what I'm talking about? Oh, my goodness. Oh, our taxes are due. Our taxes are due. Oh, my goodness. I got to tell. Now, if I'm watching TV, that never happens. Right? I'm watching Gilligan's Island. I'm like, hey, this is awesome. Reruns. You know, I don't have cable. But, you know, whatever. But isn't it amazing? And sometimes we need to discipline ourselves and say, hey, I'm going to pray even when my brain wants to do anything else. How many know that's the enemy? It really is. You're not that responsible, really. You're not. That's the enemy trying to distract you. Now, another thing people might say, but Craig, I'm just so busy. And guess what? We are. We're Oro Valleyans. We're Northwest Tucson's. We're type A people. We're busy. We don't even know what we're busy about, but we're busy. Daniel was the prime minister of Babylon, the most powerful nation or empire in the known world at the time. I think he was busy as anyone in this room. What do you bet? And yet, he still found the time to pray 3 times a day. And we'll go, oh, but that's just Daniel. Hear this, guys. I have not learned this truth as much as I'd like, but how many know Martin Luther, the great reformer? Martin Luther, 450 years ago, we're still talking about him today. It's pretty cool, right? Probably 4 days after I'm gone, people, what was that guy's name? The big guy? What was it? You know, 450 years. But guess what he said? He put his 97 thesis on the door about why it's not we're saved by grace and not by works. And guess what? You know what he said that day? He said, today is the busiest day of my life. Today I must pray all the more. How many know God? He said this too. God can do one more in 1 second of your prayer than you can do in a whole lifetime. How many know Daniel knew that? Daniel was successful because he would take all his cares and worries. Have you ever noticed when you've prayed how everything just seems to go good? Have you ever noticed how the clock seems to go slow? You look at the clock, you go, it's still only 9 o'clock. But if I don't pray, guess what? It's 9 p.m. at night? Oh, my goodness. You know, right? Put the Lord first. Test, taste, and see if the Lord is good. Try it. Don't do it because it's legalism. Don't do it because, do it because you're sick and tired of being sick and tired. Because you want to be like Daniel. You want to prosper. How many like to prosper, truly, in all that you do? You guys are too tired to put your hands up. Daniel, 85, he'd be like, Here it is. They prospered. Why did he prosper? 3 things. Recap real quick, and I'm done. So some of you are looking at me like, the clock. You get this stuff, I'll quit preaching it. There you go. No, I'm kidding. Because Daniel was a man of continual prayer, that's number one thing. And because he's a man of continual prayer, number two, because of that, he was what? Filled with the Holy Spirit. You can't be pray continually and not be filled with the Holy Spirit. And if you are praying continually, you should be praying in your prayer, fill me with the Holy Spirit, guide me, direct me, empower me. And then lastly, thirdly, you can't be continually filled with the Holy Spirit and abiding in the vine without bearing much fruit. Amen? A lot of us are apples. Have you ever been around an apple tree? Apples can look good off the tree for a long time, but all you have to do is just touch an apple. That's what they do. The shell's nice, but inside it's just mush. How many of that's a lot of us? We're walking around. Someone touch it. Ooh. But how many know you and I need to abide in the vine? And if we abide in the vine, we are going to bear fruit. We are going to stay, as it says in Psalms 1, about we're going to be that tree planted by the rivers of water which bear fruit that in and out of season, that have their leaves do not turn brown. They're always green. And I don't know about you, but God is saying, church, let's start abiding in the vine. Let's start bearing fruit, not for our glory, but for his glory. Amen? Bless you guys. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your love. And I pray, God, that this is not new stuff, but it's stuff that we can humbly say a lot of us don't do. Amen? A lot of us know we should pray, but a lot of us go throughout the whole day without really spending any time with you. Or we might just throw out a prayer as we're putting on our makeup in the car. Well, hopefully not men, but, you know, but we'll just kind of throw up prayers, oh, bless this day, Lord. But Father, Daniel would literally get on his knees and spend morning and spend afternoon and spend the night. He would pray 3 times a day. We don't know how long, but he would just make those times to spend time with you. I pray that you would help us to do that, amen? Give us the strength, Lord. Give us the discipline, Lord. Let us realize this man is 85 and he still did this for 70 years. He was a prime minister of Babylon, and yet he made the time to seek you. And because of that, he prospered. Let us remember that, to pray. And then as we pray, to be asked to be filled. And then as we asked to abide, then you said this, Jesus, in John 15:7, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you desire and it shall be given to you. Church, a lot of us have asked for a lot of things, but we don't see the answer. And I believe God would take us back to say, are you abiding in me? Are you dwelling in me? Are you remaining in me? Are you reading my word? Are you praying? Because if we are, then we cannot help. But Jesus will, we can't be connected to the vine, Jesus, his life-giving spirit, and not bear fruit. So let that get through to our hearts, and let that get through to our minds, to where we say today humbly, just say that to the Lord, I want, teach me, Lord. Teach me how to pray. Teach me how to spend time with you. Teach me how to read your word. And then, Lord, fill me with your spirit. And help me, Lord, to bear fruit. Help me to prosper in all that you've given me to do, that I would bring glory to your name, that I, like Daniel, could be under four different bosses or four different regimes or four different workplaces. In every workplace, I prosper because I am with you and you are with me. Let us believe that, that you are no respecter of persons, that you love us as much as you love Daniel. But you love Daniel in a special way because Daniel sought you and you said that you will strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to you. I pray that everyone in this room will want to be fully committed to you and your ways. We ask this and we believe for it, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, amen.